have some announcements. We are holding the flags. Please respect the flag. Do not let it touch the ground. Hold it up high. How do you hold the flag up? Be proud. Perfect. Thank you so much. So let's begin with our chief guest. And to introduce our chief guest, let me request Dr. Prasad Todakara, chairman of MGMNT, to please come and introduce our chief guest.
Thank you. Thank you, Sneha. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for coming to commemorate International Day of Non-Violence, which is declared by UNO. This is a great pride moment, whole universe, to spread the message of peace and peace and harmony. And we gathered here to celebrate our Mahatma Gandhiji's 146th birthday. As you are aware, we inaugurated this last year, October 2nd, Thursday, even though it was not a weekend. This place was crowded by a lot of young, youth, and also senior citizens to come and to pay tribute to Mahatma Gandhiji. There is no other place in the, especially in USA, this magnitude of Mahatma Gandhi Memorial, we all feel proud of it. This is not possible only with one person, one organization, one individual. This is a community project. We first of all thank CTF Irving for allowing us to have this beautiful monument here. And also a lot of supporters. Without their support, it is not possible. We would like to mention a few names, Mr. Ramesh and Kalpana ji, Mrs. Kalpana Bhatia, as well as Amy is here for co-collection, Trammell Crow, Om Singla and his wife Indra Singla, Chandra Patel, Phanesia. These are all people who participated very enthusiastically to make this happen. We have a dream, but we need to realize the dream with the support of the community. That happened. We want to take only 1 minute from you. Today we stand here to talk about or to remember the essence of the message of Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi's message was Sarvodaya. Sarvodaya means welfare, welfare for all people. That can be achieved only with dignity, equality, and as well as treating everyone with respect. That is only possible. And also he envisioned a fundamental society with truth, non-violence, love, compassion, and equality. These principles we need to remember, and we need to remember, take this message to the next generation. Thank you all for coming for this morning, early morning. And I would love to invite our chief guest. We need to specially thank her. As you know, October 2nd is the busiest day in the world, not only in India, pushing all her programs aside, and with a lot of love and passion here, she came to see this project as well as to talk to you. She is representing not only Kasturba Foundation as a trustee, but she is also heading a project called Akshara Culture Society, which grassroots level organization which supports youth, orphan children, and also training programs. Lot of things they do all over India, and please give her a big hand to welcome Sukanya Bharatra. He is the probably most of you know, she is the great grandfather of Mahatma Gandhiji, who is taking his ideals to forward, and the whole family is involved with community service. Please give her a big round of applause.
Thank you, friends. It's an honor for me to be here today. Namaste. And good morning. It's a beautiful day here in Irving. First of all, I would like to thank everyone here who has made this event possible, and thank my host, the Mahatma Gandhi Memorial of North Texas, and especially the chairperson, Dr. Prasad Todakara, for having me here. And for thank you everybody for the friendship and the kindness shown to me in the last 2-3 days that I've been here. It's I didn't know about Irving till I came here, and I realized that Irving is a city that celebrates inclusivity. It's a city that celebrates friendship. It's a city that celebrates hard work, integration, brotherhood, friendship. And these are all core fundamental issues that Gandhiji talked about. So it's very fitting that this memorial is here and can give a message of peace, not just to Texas, but I'm sure to the whole of the country. So actually, I don't really know what to say, because the two young men here from school spoke so beautifully. You said everything. I really don't need to say anything more now. So, and it proves that Gandhiji belongs to the whole world. It doesn't just, he is not, cannot be confined to a family, to a country, to a religion. He cannot be confined to a race, to an ism. He cannot be confined to a thought process. He belongs to everyone. Gandhiji, Mahatma Gandhi, did not have a Gandhi before him. It's important to remember. He was a seeker, and the voice of his conscience made itself felt, and he heard it from a very young age. He was inspired by thinkers and writers and philosophers spanning history, cultures, religions. He was born in the Hindu faith, but as he discovered new worlds, he became profoundly influenced by the teachings of Christ, by the writings of Tolstoy, the philosophy of Henry David Thoreau and John Ruskin. He was influenced by the teachings of Christ, the principles of peace of Islam, the solidarity and courage of the Jewish faith. In fact, later in life, he incorporated multi-faith prayers in every gathering that he held anywhere in India. He worked in and assimilated the cultures of three continents. However, the period of greatest self-discovery came to him in South Africa, where he went first in 1893. He returned to India finally in 1915, which is exactly 100 years ago. In this country, in South Africa, he became a political activist, and his religious and spiritual quest came to a maturity. Here, he first started to put in practice the life of social conscience. In fact, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi became Mahatma Gandhi in South Africa. As Nelson Mandela said, and I quote, "The Mahatma is an integral part of the history because it is here that he first experimented with truth, here that he demonstrated his characteristic firmness in pursuit of justice, here that he developed satyagraha as a philosophy and a method of struggle." Mahatma Gandhi was, throughout his life, able to inspire others. There was an innate kindness in him. And before advocating any path, he practiced it on himself. He had the extraordinary ability to look for the essence in everything around him. And he lived, he didn't just preach it, the motto, "No man can live without religion." He wrote, and I quote, "My Hindu instinct tells me that all religions are more or less true. Religions are different roads converging to the same point. What does it matter that we take different roads so long as we reach the same goal? In reality, there are as many religions as there are people." He always lived in the present, yet he fought for a fair and just future. He was an idealist who believed in the inherent goodness of man, yet he was intensely practical. His belief was that we are all spiritual beings, going through this human experience, and therefore we are custodians of this planet for future generations. We live for a finite time, and what happens next, we do not know. What we do know is that what we do now is in our hands. His vision for the whole of mankind, and not just for India, was founded on the twin principles of Satyagraha and Sarvodaya, as the two young men recently just now told us. Satyagraha is the constant search for truth and justice through nonviolence, ahimsa. Ahimsa, the root of satyagraha is in prayer. The fight of satyagraha is for the strong in spirit, not the doubter of the timid, he wrote. Without ahimsa, he wrote again, it is not possible to seek and find truth. Ahimsa and truth are so intertwined that it is practically impossible to disentangle and separate them. Sarvodaya. Sarvodaya was initially the title given to the Gujarati translation of John Ruskin's book, Unto the Last. This, for Gandhi, this term came to mean the advancement of all, not merely of the greatest number. Sarvodaya for Gandhi was a renaissance in the consciousness of man in order to live as one with nature and the environment and with fellow human beings without exploitation and without fear. Non-violence for him was not a passive situation. It wasn't just the absence of violence, but actually the removal of anger, resentment, revenge from the mind. Pollution of our air and water is also violence. For Mahatma Gandhi, the opposite of love was fear, and a non-violent struggle was not a passive movement, but one based on fearlessness. This quality is the first thing indispensable before we could achieve anything permanent and real. This quality is unattainable without religious consciousness. Let us fear God, and we shall cease to fear man, he wrote in 1916. And as anyone who met him testified, Gandhiji himself never inspired fear. Even his most bitter opponents would part with him with a sense of having been disarmed and charmed. In 1925, Gandhiji wrote what he thought were the seven social sins, namely, wealth without work, pleasure without conscience, knowledge without character, commerce without morality, science without humanity, religion without sacrifice, politics without principles. These were for him the seven social sins. He is a subject of endless study, and he always will be. He was a man of his era, but his inner search made him a timeless figure. He was always a teacher. He was always concerned about people's health, and he nursed those around him himself. He worked with leprosy patients, both in South Africa and India. He strived for the dignity of women, brought them to the forefront of the freedom struggle. He fought for the upliftment of the Harijans. He spoke about the environment. He identified with the poorest, believed in the dignity of labor, but he didn't judge the wealthy. He traveled to every nook and corner of India in a third-class compartment. He was a hard taskmaster, but always first with himself. He believed in the essential goodness of every individual. I can fully identify with Albert Einstein's quote where he said that generations to come will scarce believe that such a one as this ever in flesh and blood walked upon this earth. And generations have been inspired by Gandhi, and he now does belong to the world, to the whole of humanity. He cannot be, as I said earlier, restricted to man-made boundaries. Dr. Martin Luther King said of Gandhiji, if humanity is to progress, Gandhi is inescapable. He went on to say, we may ignore him at our peril. Lord Mountbatten, Britain's last viceroy, said upon hearing of Gandhiji's assassination, India, indeed the world, will not see the like of him again, perhaps for centuries. In my opinion, however, one of the most telling tributes to the Mahatma came from General Douglas MacArthur. He said, nothing more revolting has occurred in the history of modern world than the senseless assassination of this venerable man. That he should die by violence is one of those bitter anachronisms that seem to refute all logic. In the evolution of civilization, if it is to survive, all men cannot fail eventually to adopt his belief that the process of mass application of force to resolve contentious issues is fundamentally not only wrong, but contains within itself the germs of self-destruction. Gandhi, however, was one of those prophets who lived far ahead of the times, unquote. Gandhiji was a visionary, and his message of nonviolence was his gift to humanity. Thank you all, and wish everyone a very pleasant day ahead and a good peace march.